one thing to note just right off the bat, and this is probably a sermon series in and of itself, but that first verse is kind of neat. We did a little section on Jesus' prayer life at youth group this year, and we kind of noted some of the marks of how Jesus prayed, and there's many. And you get a little snapshot into Jesus' prayer life at the beginning here, and this isn't where we're going to spend a considerable amount of time this morning, but I thought it was worth mentioning because it's so neat. So one, it says he went out to the mountainside to pray. He withdraws. He goes to get focused. He needs to be alone to be able to spend time with God. He cuts out time to get away to spend time with God. We see that often, that Jesus goes out into the wilderness or goes up to a mountain to pray, and that's a mark of Jesus' prayer life. He likes to get focused. He likes to cut out time. This also happens a lot, seemingly before or after major miracles or teachings. Jesus often withdraws to pray. So that's another mark of Jesus' prayer life. He prays often. He realizes how important it is to his life and his ministry. And then the big one that's maybe most shocking to us is he spends the night praying. When we did this in youth group, I had people raise hands. How many of you have spent an entire night praying? I don't think we got any. I won't make you do it here because it probably doesn't exactly make us look good. But Jesus spends the night praying. That's amazing. But it also tells us that what's coming is important. Jesus thought that this next moment in ministry was going to be so monumental, so important for his people to listen to, that he needed an entire night to pray, ask God for guidance and wisdom, get his spirit in a good place to come and make this big decision to call 12 of his disciples to be apostles. So also worth noting, when sometimes in scriptures where it mentioned Jesus' disciples, it means all of his followers. So if you remember the feeding of the 5,000, there were 5,000 men in attendance when Jesus was preaching. So these are thousands upon thousands of people, upwards of 10,000, maybe even 20,000 people following Jesus, gathering to hear him preach. And so here, when it says he called the disciples together, these are that 10 plus thousand people. And out of that many, he chooses 12. I'm a Milwaukee Bucks fan, and I suppose by extension that makes me a fan of the NBA. There's not many of us. I don't see Alec. Alec's a big one. Adam's here. Adam's a big one. Becca is. Trey is becoming a strong Bucks fan. That's great. So I suppose by extension I understand the NBA a little bit. And they made a change this year to the All-Star game. The Western Conference is significantly better than the Eastern Conference, so the games had gotten boring. The West just demolishes the East every time. So they decided to make a change. They said, this year we're going to get our best two players, and we're going to let them draft whoever they want to play on their All-Star team. Well, the players said, this is a great idea, but we are not going to televise it, and we do not want it to get out who we picked. There's a lot of interpersonal drama, and you got to consider people's feelings. No one likes to get picked last, and what if you pick a teammate after you pick someone else, or you don't pick a teammate? It could be a whole thing. When Jesus does his fantasy disciple draft, he makes sure that everyone is in attendance. Jesus does not care to do this in secret. This is a big moment. And we'll flesh that out a little bit as we get to meet some of these guys. And I'm relying pretty heavily on this book. It's by a pastor, John MacArthur, who's a wonderful minister. It's called 12 Ordinary Men. I am not much of a read-for-pleasure kind of guy. This was one that I was able to do that for. It is really well done. Often when we have books or look into the lives of smaller Bible people, we do a lot of kind of projecting and guessing. John MacArthur does a really nice job of making sure Scripture is first, that we're looking through the lens of Scripture to find characteristics and traits and understand these men. So it's really well done. So there's going to be a lot of content here. I'll tell you, there is an outline on the back of the blue note. If that's going to help you follow along, do that. If just listening and kind of shutting out all that other stuff is going to help you, do that, because we're going to fly through a lot of these guys this morning. And I want to kind of take them two by two, because it works out nice. So our first pair, the first two that we get called in Luke chapter 6, Simon, who Jesus called Peter, and Andrew. Simon was a big deal. Such a big deal, in fact, that Jesus gives him the nickname Peter, which means rock, and tells him, "You are the rock on whom I will build my church." Peter is important. He's a fisherman. He's from a small town called Bethsaida. He's not just a fisherman, though. We note in Scripture that the other guys are his partners. So he's kind of the business owner, which is consistent with his character. He's kind of the one who takes action. Simon Peter's the guy in every room who's always talking and always driving the conversation. He's the one who makes plans for the group of friends. He's a big doer. We see that as in Acts 1, he decides that the group must replace Judas Iscariot. When the Holy Spirit comes on the people in Acts 2, it's Peter who stands up and addresses the crowd in their first public ministry after Jesus' ascension. And it's there that 3,000 people decide to give their lives to Jesus Christ. Even Jesus seems to notice this because he calls him his rock. But before you begin to imagine Peter as this Forbes top 10 businessman, great manager of the year, it's worth noting that he's not so affectionately called the disciple with the foot-shaped mouth. MacArthur notes that he had a habit of revving his mouth while his brain was in neutral. He's the kind of leader you wished would keep his mouth shut every once in a while. He's the kind of leader that misreads the room about as often as he reads it correctly. He's the kind of leader that backs the group into messy corners, and yet he's annoyingly confident. This is the first guy Jesus names in this list, and he's important enough to call him the rock on whom he'll build his church. Jesus likes these kinds of people. But to contrast Peter's unwavering confidence and ability to address large crowds without batting an eye, we find his brother Andrew. Actually, after looking around for a while, we find his brother Andrew, because he's difficult to find. He is firmly implanted in his brother's shadow. Andrew, being the brother of Peter, also from a small town in Bethsaida, part of this conglomerate of fishermen, he is the first one that Jesus calls, the first disciple that Jesus says, "Come follow me," in John 1. And you might think that a lifetime of living and working with your huge ego spotlight-hogging brother might cause some resentment. Ashley's nodding like, yes, it gets old. Andrew's character is not that way at all. In fact, when Jesus calls him, it says the first thing he does has went and found his brother Simon to tell him, "We have found the Messiah." Andrew cares deeply about individuals. And we see this in a couple different situations. We see this at the feeding of the 5,000 that we mentioned earlier. The large crowd comes and Jesus says, "How are we going to feed these people?" And while the other disciples scratch their heads, Andrew goes and finds a boy with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And brings him to Jesus. He brings him to Jesus. Just like he brought his brother to Jesus. And just like in John chapter 12, when the Greeks came in search of Jesus, Philip's not so sure what to do. And Philip went to tell Andrew, and Andrew in turn brought them to Jesus. Already in the first two names, we have this huge spectrum of people. On one hand, we have Peter, who's bold and brash and confident and willing to stand up and address large crowds, even though he might make the interpersonal mistakes. And on the other end of the spectrum, we have Andrew, who never is addressing a crowd but cares so deeply about one person and wants to bring him to Jesus at all costs. This is going to be fun. We got a couple more brothers, James and John. So if Jesus is drafting his all-star team, he's got Peter, he's the ball hog, 30-point-per-game scorer. He's got Andrew, he's kind of the pass-first point guard kind of guy. Now everybody needs like a Bill Laimbeer, a Dennis Rodman type. You need your muscle, your bruiser. So Jesus goes and he gets James and John. James and John are also fishermen. They're part of the same fishing conglomerate with Simon Peter and Andrew. James and John, though, are like the Bash Brothers and Mighty Ducks. They are like punch first, worry about people later. In fact, they're nicknamed the Sons of Thunder. That's an endearing nickname, Sons of Thunder. This is the muscle. These are guys who care so, so, so deeply about truth. And that's a good thing. They care so deeply about truth. But at the expense of people. To them, life is black and white. And if you're not on the right side of things, get away. In fact, in one instance in Luke 9, it says, the people in Samaria did not welcome Jesus. They were looking for a place to stay, and the people in Samaria would have nothing to do with Jesus. And this bothered James and John so much that their first reaction says, when the disciples James and John saw this, they asked, Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to destroy them? These are the fire and brimstone, pound the pulpit type pastors. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. But you can imagine if you know people like this, that they can rub people the wrong way. So it's not surprising that James, the older brother of the two, was the first to be martyred. He was put to death by the sword. He was beheaded by Herod. First to be martyred. He only made it to Acts chapter 12. By contrast, again, we get two different stories. His brother, John, was the only disciple never to be martyred. He died, as far as we can tell, in his 90s of old age. Now, John went on to pen the Gospel, John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and also Revelation. And we see from his writings that over time, John he softened up a little bit. So if these are the sons of thunder, if these are the black and white truth proclaimers, James is kind of firmly there, but John's kind of that bold, brash guy with the sensitive side. These next three people are very different. So far, we've had four fishermen from Bethsaida, Capernaum. And what we usually think of disciples as fishermen is, well, they're tradesmen, they're uneducated. And while that's true, it's not really a fair assessment. Because these guys aren't just fishermen. They're fishermen in Capernaum, which is on the Sea of Galilee. They're fishermen in a place where fishing is really good. And not just fishing is really good, but they're on a major trade route. So these guys are doing pretty well for themselves. They seem to have quite the business. It's mentioned in Scripture that they had servants working for them. So they're successful businessmen. They're also disciples of John the Baptist, all four of them. That's where Jesus finds them. So they know the Scriptures well. And they're family men, too. They all have families. They remind me a little bit of Aaron Gesh when I was working at the lumberyard. He was a tradesman, and you might think just a tradesman. But these are the kind of guys who are doing really well for themselves, are really good at their jobs, and also are taking night classes to become a pastor and have a busy family life at home. Starting to sound a little bit familiar to the typical Oostburg person, busy, 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 busy people. Well, these next three guys, Philip, Bartholomew, who often is called Nathaniel. I said some of them have two names, so don't get confused there. Philip, Bartholomew, and Thomas maybe fit that traditional fisherman stereotype a little bit better. These are kind of your small-town simpletons. And they actually remind me a lot of the American church today, and we'll get there. Let me introduce you to Philip. Philip has a Greek name. Philip is a Greek name that means lover of horses. He's also a fisherman from near Bethsaida. And when Jesus calls him in John chapter 1, he has a similar call to Andrew. Jesus calls him, and Philip's first response is to go find Nathanael, also Bartholomew. We'll try to keep all this straight. He goes and finds his friend Nathanael and tells him, we have found the one Moses wrote about. Very similar to Andrew, right? Jesus calls him, and his first response is to go get somebody and bring him to Christ. Worth noting, Jesus called Philip, and Philip responded in faith. This is real faith. But as we look into Philip's character deeper and deeper, we find that his faith is a little weak. Maybe this has something to do with he's got one foot in Jesus' camp and one foot that he's still in the world. And this might be a reflection of his family. He's got a Greek name, so now I am projecting a little bit. Maybe his family cares about being real cultural and hip, and so they adopted Greek culture pretty early on. Philip has a hard time totally committing. His call is similar to Andrew, but the way he responds in situations is very different. At the feeding of the 5,000, we said, Andrew went and found the boy with 5 loaves and 2 fish and said, this is enough for Jesus. The way that story goes, though, is Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him. He said to Philip, where shall we buy bread for these people to eat? He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 8 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. Philip's worried about the money. Philip's a realist. Jesus, we can't feed all these people. Are you crazy? Similar situation to Andrew again. When the Greeks come, they come to Philip first. And while it's always Andrew's first response to drag people to Jesus, Philip's not so sure. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to tell Andrew. He's a protocol guy and a little bit of a cynic. I don't know, these are Greeks and we haven't really spent a lot of time up there. Do you think Jesus would really want to see these guys? I don't know how Jesus feels about the Greeks. He has a hard time getting over his old self. There's still some things that are weak about Philip's faith. The worst example is at the Last Supper. MacArthur writes that the disciples still show pathetically weak faith, and that this was true of Philip in particular. Of all the foolish, impetuous, heartbreakingly ignorant statements that occasionally escaped the lips of the disciples, none was more disappointing than Philip's remark in the upper room. At the Last Supper, Jesus explains to them that he will soon leave them and go to heaven to prepare a place for them. A very confused, apprehensive, as he oft is, Philip asks, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. This disappoints Jesus, because Philip has spent all this time following Jesus, listening to his teaching, observing his power, and yet he has totally misunderstood who Jesus is. His buddy Bartholomew, or Nathanael, doesn't fare much better, also a fisherman from near Cana. He was someone who knew the scriptures well. We find him also following John the Baptist. When Philip goes and gets him and tells him about the Messiah, Nathanael's response, Bartholomew's response is, Nazareth? Can anything good come from there? He's prejudiced. That kind of person can't be the Messiah. You can't really be following that type of person. But when he goes and meets Jesus, Jesus says, you, Nathanael, you have genuine faith. So again, like Philip, this is real faith. This is a real follower who wants to try. But again, he experiences hang-up after hang-up of getting over certain worldly things that are affecting his mind in a negative way. And Thomas is this to a T. I love this little quote here. He was like Eeyore in Winnie the Pooh. Painfully pessimistic and cynical. Excuse me. In one instance, Jesus wants to go, after Lazarus has died, Jesus wants to go visit the family, and they need to go back to Judea to do this. They had just fled Judea because the people there wanted to kill Jesus, and Thomas says, well, we'll follow you to our death then. Again, strong faith because he's willing to follow, but he misses the power. He misses what Jesus is trying to do. Friends, we're told that Nathanael and Philip were students of the Old Testament together. In all likelihood, they went out to the wilderness to hear John the Baptist together. They had a shared interest in the fulfillment of the Old Testament. And this is what strikes me as so similar to the American church. We are people who have spent a considerable amount of time following Jesus. We are people who have listened to the teachings. We are often students of the scripture, interested in their final fulfillment. But we're not willing to put to death our old self. We care too deeply for the things of the world. Like Philip, money and status are problems for us. Like Bartholomew, prejudice is a problem for us. And like Thomas, painful cynicism is a problem for us. If apprehension is the buzzword for these three guys, extremism is the buzzword for our next two. I said at the outset that Matthew is the same tax collector that is called Levi in the chapter before. So I won't spend a lot of time. We got a picture into who tax collectors are last week a little bit. But Matthew is a tax collector, and he is viewed as a traitor to the Jewish people. These are people who sold their soul to the Romans for a big purse. They are known to lead excessive and immoral lifestyles. They make a lot of money and they spend it living it up. In fact, the Jews believe that tax collectors were so far gone that they were past the point of repentance and wouldn't even let them in the church anymore, wouldn't even let them in the synagogue. And so Jesus goes to that type of person and says, "Follow me." And then he goes and finds Simon the Zealot. Zealots are not unlike jihadists. They are religious extremists. They thought that the Romans taking control of the Jews were usurping the power of God, and they were going to end that at all costs by inciting riots. And how better to incite a riot than by assassinating Romans? They were mercenaries. They were assassins. They carried sicarii. They were called the dagger men because they had these curved daggers that they concealed, and they would walk into crowded places and murder Roman rulers, including tax collectors. So Jesus takes these two people, a tax collector and a religious extremist bent on killing tax collectors, and puts them in crowded places and small boats for several months. Only Jesus, right? And so here we have this extreme again. We have this person whose life is so sinful, they believe they're beyond repair, that they can't even be in the church. Can we imagine those types of people we keep at an arm's length? We don't even want them in our congregation because they make us uncomfortable. They have the kind of sin that just we don't deal well with, so stay away. In fact, we might even make conversion difficult on them because we don't really want them. That's Matthew. And on the other side is Simon, this guy who's legalistic. He's the legalist of all legalists, who takes everything insanely literal. A little bit like James and John, he's bent on truth and cares very little about other people. And only Jesus could make that work together. And finally, and these guys are my favorite, he's known as James the Lesser, because there's another James we talked about. I call him Lil James. James the Lesser, and we call him James the Lesser because he doesn't have much going on for himself. We don't hear about him too much in Scripture. We actually hear more about his mom. His mom is one of the Marys who are often with Jesus. His brother is Joseph, who is mentioned with Jesus on a couple of occasions. He's a mama's boy. And also Judas, who's called Thaddeus. In another place, they call him Judas not Iscariot. And I kind of imagine that's how he introduces himself to people after the betrayal. Hi, I'm Judas, not Iscariot. So he always leads with that. So I call him Good Judas. Thaddeus was his nickname, and it means mama's boy. So these are a couple of guys who are quiet, they're meek, they care very deeply about their family, but maybe the familiar is so enticing to them, it's to their detriment, because we don't really hear about them much. They're not really willing to step out the way the other disciples are. They're a little bit timid. They need to keep mom and brother and sister close. And so these are the real quiet, meek people who care deeply about family, but are kind of stuck in the familiar. So back to Luke 6. Here Jesus is coming down this mountainside. He calls all of his disciples together, maybe upwards of 10,000 people. And the statement he makes here is, There is no type of person I can't use. There is no type of person I can't use. People might have thought there was some set of strengths that you had to have. There was some weaknesses that disqualified yourself. But if we run down this list of apostles, we see that some were confident. Some cared deeply about the individual. Some had strong faith. Some cared deeply about truth and existed in the black and white. Simon had incredible zeal for the Lord. They cared deeply about family. There's all different kinds of strengths, all different kinds of people. And if some weakness should disqualify you, they ran their mouths, they were timid, they had terrible interpersonal skills, they were apprehensive, prejudiced, they had long lists of sins, cynical, and couldn't step out of their comfort zones. The statement Jesus makes as he selects these 12 men is to say, there is no one that I can't use. MacArthur writes, there's at least one of every imaginable personality. Can you find yourself somewhere in this list of people? Are you confident? Are you timid? Do you care about preaching to the masses, or do you care about relationships with individuals? Are you a family man or a family woman? Are you a cynic? Do you have strong faith? Do you have weaker faith? Do you come having met all the requirements of a legalist, or do you come with a really sinful past? Can you find yourself somewhere in this list of apostles? MacArthur also writes, are you beginning to get the idea of what kind of people God uses? He can use anyone. Personality, status, and family background are all immaterial. So much so that I left one out. I left out Judas Iscariot. Now, while these other disciples all became people who went on to die for the sake of preaching the gospel of Christ, Jesus equipped them to the point that they were willing to go out and teach and preach to the point of death. Jesus makes a statement with Judas Iscariot as well. Judas Iscariot was the group treasurer, and he stole from the treasury. He was a thief. He was greedy and selfish, a hypocrite and expert liar. Those closest to him thought he had real faith, but he was a traitor. Emotionally unstable, he struggled with some mental instabilities. The point Jesus makes by even including Judas Iscariot is that whether or not you're going to help, I'm going to accomplish my will through you. Jesus says, not only am I not concerned about certain strengths or certain weaknesses, my will be accomplished, whether you work towards it or not. And Judas Iscariot certainly thought he was going to thwart Jesus' ministry. He was going to thwart the will of God. He was going to put a stop to what Jesus was doing. And little did he know, God was going to be so glorified through even Judas Iscariot. There is no one Jesus can't use. So what type of person are you? This last Wednesday, we had this wonderful panel discussion at youth group. We brought in people from different ministries, some deacons, some elders, care committee, Acts 1:8, some personal testimonies, some of our missionaries. And we said, what are different things we can get involved in? What are different ways we can help our church community and our local community to meet the needs of people and to bring the gospel? And we had this great conversation of all these different types of ministries for different types of people. I directed the students to our church website, firstcrcusburg.org/ministries, has this long list of different ministries we put on or we support, and said, find a way to be used by God. Find a way to be used by God. And as true as that is for our students, it's true for all of us. Because no matter which disciple you find yourself most closely associated with, the point that Jesus makes in Luke chapter 6 is, You guys play an important role in setting that tone for us. A couple weeks back, we had our denominational winter retreat for the classes. We were at Fort Wilderness for winter retreat, and the series, the speaker was talking about evangelism. And at the end of the week, we gathered our students around, and we said, you guys have great faith. What does our church need to do to equip you to be evangelists, to do outreach, to make disciples? And they came up with some great suggestions, some things we've done in the past, and yeah, community meals, they like that, and more training at youth group, yeah, we've had some lessons about that, we'll do some more of that. But one of the things one of the students said, I think is very pertinent for the church to hear, and they said, we want mentors who show us how to do it. Our students are looking to you, adults, to show them how to be used by God. Our students are watching, and they want you to show them how to be used by God. So will you. Because this cast of misfit characters in Luke chapter 6, these 12 apostles of varying maturity and different walks of life, these are the people that Jesus stood in front of and said, go and make disciples of all nations. It's these people, these misfits, these ordinary guys that Jesus equips to do his work. And it's this congregation, it's Christians everywhere, across time and across space, that Jesus stands in front of. He's given you his word, and he says, go and make disciples of all nations. Jesus makes a statement here that there is no one he can't use. He can use you. He can use me. Well, Pastor Ben made an interesting distinction that I really appreciated when we had our panel discussion. He said, this desire to be doers, to go out and do things is great, but you can do that without Jesus. You can go and feed the hungry without Jesus. There's people doing that. You can go and clothe the homeless. You can go and heal the sick. You can give care to the sick without Jesus. People do that every day. And if we do it that way, we're missing the point. Because what we have to offer people is a Savior who died in our place, a Savior who took on our sins, a Savior who willingly went to the cross that not just our physical needs could be met, but that he could include us, like Romans 8 said at the beginning of the service, in his family, make us heirs to the throne of God. It says, joint heirs with Christ. We have the same righteousness as Jesus Christ only because he gifts it to us. And while it's important that we go out and work, if we don't bring that gospel message wherever we go, like Luke chapter 5 said, it's not the healthy that need the doctor, it's the sick. We're not healing the sick if we don't bring them the gospel. Jesus can use you to bring the gospel. Let's commit to doing that. Amen. Let's pray.